Good morning, everyone. This is Chaitali Bhav from the European Bureau of Aviation and Defense Universe, based out of Cyprus. And ADU is continuing with its countdown to the 89th Indian Air Force Day. And no discussion can be complete without having the representation of more than half population of the nation, which is of us women. So today we have Squadron Leader Prerna Chaturvedi with us, who not only joined the male bastion of the Indian Air Force, but also broke the myth that women cannot be a part of the armed forces other than the medical branch. Prerna, welcome to ADU's chat room. We are also an all-women organization and are privileged to have you here with us in taking the story ahead of Indian women are at par, if not better than men. I now request ADU's editor, Sangeeta Saxena, to steer the discussion ahead.
Thank you very much, Chaitali. Prerna, it's a pleasure to have you here. And you know, I mean, we've been waiting and waiting and waiting for this occasion to come. I cannot forget the years of being a part of an aviation setup together. And you know, I always felt that there couldn't have been a better person to tell us about how it was to be in the Indian Air Force. Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Sangeeta ma'am. Thank you very much, Chaitali ma'am, for such a wonderful introduction. I must tell you, I am reliving every minute of my earlier days as I stand to speak about those days with both of you. And Chaitali ma'am, like you rightly mentioned, we are at least half of the population. And we bring so much power to each of the organizations that we visit. It's only for us to realize, and also the organizations to realize as the time flies, how much value do we add to each other? It's a fantastic learning in a life. And I think we were so lucky to have been offered this as the flag bearers to bring this change into the Indian Air Force. We couldn't have been luckier. Fantastic to connect with both of you. And I'm looking forward to sharing some of our lessons and relearning them together.
And now, you know, my first question to you, Prerna, is that when did you join the Indian Air Force?
Ma'am, we started in 95. So, and it's a very, very interesting answer to this question. Physically, to 95 mein academy mein pahunche the, but by the time we made up our minds, it was already 1990, 91. Even before the advertisement was out in the newspapers, welcoming women to apply for these locations and for these positions, we were part of the NCC. And it is the NCC which sort of drew us into wanting to be there in uniform. It's a big time credit that goes to NCC on this, that they offered us a platform to prove our worth and to build a statement of case that we could take to the chiefs and say, why would you not allow us to participate? And haven't we done already enough to prove that yes, we can? Even if there was a chance of any of us failing to comply or to succeed, at least we had the opportunity to evaluate our own selves. And it was that opportunity which was offered at that time by all the three services. It's a fantastic connect, ma'am. It's a fantastic connect. I still remember we were with General Rodriguez over a cup of tea. And when we were trying to push our case and submit that, yes, sir, we can do it. And this is what we want to do. We want to be able to do our best. I won't say we want to do as much as the other men are doing, equal to them, but yes, while they are doing their best, I would also like to do my best, whatever that means in our limited capacity at that time. Neither ourselves nor the organizations knew what would be the outcome of that discussion and what would that best equal to with respect to each other. And this was one of the most valuable lessons we learned from that day, ma'am. So equality was not in sheer muscle strength or in the number of kilometers that one would be able to run. but it was in the willingness to be able to give our 100%. And that's where I think we all were super successful in proving a case. And we were very, very lucky that when the advertisement was out, General Rodriguez again called me in for that cup of tea at his place. And he said, here it is, prepare your application and now you're ready to go. Isn't this what you wanted? I don't think I found anyone in this world more blessed than I was on that day.
That's wonderful, actually wonderful. And how old you were at this time? Were you in school or were you in college? What was the status quo at that time?
I was 19 and a half that time.
Okay.
Less than half my age at this time. And such may, ma'am, I think this is the story that we have already collected to tell our grandchildren. When the advertisements were out, of course, then the world started to change for all of us. The perception changed. Our efforts that we were putting in this direction changed. They were more result oriented. They were more focused. They were not all over the place. One knew which arm did you want to go into, whether you were looking for signals or education or the flying branch. And again, we were very lucky that the women initially were offered the flying branch and to fly fixed wings and then the helicopters. How lucky we were. And also thankful to the organization to give us that equal opportunity platform to perform. Although there is a lot that remained from that day onwards and even till date in terms of wish list. But like humans, we all are. The wish list will never finish. But yes, with whatever we've been offered since 95 onwards, the graph has just gone on forward and forward. And this is where I feel we are all blessed to be part of this organization. And we associate still so strongly.
So you met General Rodriguez, who was the Army Chief, and you joined the Air Force. So what was that miss? You didn't go into the Army, or the Army didn't let women enter at that time and Air Force pioneered? So just tell us that little story.
Ma'am, I must tell you, you're an insider and you're fishing this out of me. I know. And you're heading into just the right direction by asking this question. When General Rodriguez showed that advertisement and I asked him, I said, but this is for the education branch. I wanted to be in infantry or the armored or the paras. I can 100% imagine at this age now what would have gone on his mind. Hey, beta, pehle ye to kar lo. But I also knew when he would say this question, my answer would have been the same, that I already have one life. So either I would be able to do this or this, but when I'm very sure that this is what I can do, why would I settle for anything else? And that's when the push continued. And I would say, ma'am, that time when we thought unluckily that I couldn't be the first batch to grab that advertisement and join in because I had still not finished my graduation. Maybe luckily for that time, the other women who joined in ahead of us in the Army, it substantiated our case. And it substantiated our claim that yes, we can do more. And hence, when we knocked at the Air Force door and the Air Force doors were already preconditioned to receiving our requests, the request to go to flying branch was opened much, much faster. And then the Air Force responded so fast with such a stable, equal platform that yes, all right, let the girls come in, let's start with the fixed wings wherein the infrastructure is already laid out, and then let's move to helicopters. And that's how, by the time I finished my graduation, the Air Force applications were also out.
Okay,
and
wonderful.
We realized that this is exactly what I wanted. And we got it.
And what was the training like? Did you train along with the men, or was it a separate batch for the women then?
Ma'am, the women were a different batch to begin with. And again, I would say that time also, we didn't know luckily or unluckily, but I was the only one in my batch. So, we continued with the same one batch of the men. So I have different classifications of my course mates, which is so, so interesting in life. I think I would love to relive this life one more time. So one batch of my course mates were army officers whom I was flying with and taking ground subjects classes. And those officers were already had already finished at least 5 years of service.
Okay.
The other batch was men cadets who were into flying, and I was supposed to fly with them. And they were 6 months ahead of me in seniority in Air Force service. The other batch with whom I were doing my ground subjects training, and they were at par with me, but they were from different branches, but not from the flying branch. So, of course, you were never doing a course. And even with the other women, when they were 8 or 10 or 14 of them in the batches, all the classes flying were together with the men in the same squadron. And even as the front runners to the batches, I know for sure that the Air Force never differentiated. And the first reasoning that we were given to understand was that the aircraft will never differentiate on who's flying it, the man or the woman. It's the mission performance that comes ahead of our gender or our individual abilities or wish lists. So the wish list would continue, but we also continued. And that's where I think we landed up ourselves. We found ourselves in academy, one ground duties class with men on one side, with girls on the other side, getting into parades, flying, academics. Everything started falling in place so beautifully.
I'm sure. I mean, it's an experience which gets goosebumps, absolutely. I'm sure I understand how we would have felt, you know, doing it. What was the reaction at home, Prerna? You know, parents, it's very difficult for a parent, even for men, when men want to go into the forces, for the parents to, mara bacha, you know, forces mein ja raha hai. So what was the thing at home for you?
Again, ma'am, very lucky. The NCC had opened the doors of our minds, not only my own, but also that of the family, to see the girl in uniform. And I'm talking about staying in Lucknow in 1990-91, wherein it wasn't common to find girls moving around in pants, especially jeans, and tucked in shirts with a belt. Those things were not so common to find in public. Mm-hmm. Or even in college environments. So the that opening, and then again, I was blessed having been the Lucknow Best Cadet, then UP, and then the National Best Cadet, and those progressions. The minds opened up. We built our own expectations right, step by step. And so did family. Despite being the only child at home, and knowing fully well where our parents came from, because this was not a subject of exposure in their times. And managing girls was a different kind of affair. I only remember one sentence which Dad told me. Jo achha lagta hai wo karo, par aap talwar ki dhaar par chal rahe ho.
So true.
It's a razor edge that you're walking on. Either side is a kill. And if you continue walking on it like this, you're going to hurt yourself a lot. So while you want to do this, be prepared for it.
Yes, absolutely. That is the issue.
I still get goosebumps when I think of it. And now I 100% understand what he meant by saying it, that it's not going to be easy. But if this is what you thrive on, go on. Not once. Did anyone at home, both mom and dad, give it a second thought? Or even if they would have given it a second thought, it has not been conveyed to me till date. it's a big time achievement for them. More than it is for me, I would say, to be able to manage our own emotions and thoughts and perceptions and misconceptions. They managed it all and they made sure I manage my own. And they keep their apprehensions and fears only to themselves. It hasn't come up to me till date.
Which is wonderful.
Which is wonderful. I don't know what went on, but what went into their minds. I have no idea.
Very true. Now your training got over and you came out of the portals of the academy and entered the actual Indian Air Force life. And what was the first posting like? Where did you go? How was it? I mean, just let us know all that. We are really keen to understand what went into the mind then and how did you reach and what happened. So let the story continue.
Ma'am, the first squadron, I was again very lucky. I was sent to a squadron which was a newly raised squadron. So we were part of building of that culture of that squadron. And despite being a new squadron, they already had yet another lady officer in the squadron who was flying. And she knew that I existed. I knew that she existed, though we had never flown together. And the name of the squadron was the Young Ones. And we all behaved true to the sentiment of the name, like the Young Ones, completely loaded. It was like thriving on hormones all time. Every time from morning till late at night, we were up to doing something. Super flying, exceptional set of seniors and mentors who taught us by holding our hands without us knowing who's taking us where, which was wow. I don't think I would ask for anything more in my life from there on, from our commanding officer, Sandhu sir. Everybody sort of fears a commanding officer in your first squadron. What is the CO going to be like? Who's going to thrash you? Who's going to throw you around to pieces? Who's going to batter you when you learn to fly? What will happen when you make mistakes? Again, extremely lucky, ma'am. Never, ever I was made to realize that you're a girl new to this organization. That you are a girl and that you are new. Neither way. It just felt like hot knife on butter. Effortlessly we would glide, we were gliding around and with so much fun. Never, of course, we made mistakes, umpteen. We had a lot of fun, made a lot of mistakes, learned a lot of things. But the way we were always sort of contained within like within family. Someone would guide us, hold our hands and bring us back to the right track. This is how we need to fly. I still remember some very, very senior officers who we lived together. Although the difference in seniority was still 5-6 years from the time we were, or 7, and that's hell of a lot. There was always someone waking up with us, making sure that we were sleeping right at the right time, doing the right kind of fun, doing the right kind of mischief, and being the right kind of professionals the way we had to be. Super fantastic. And then that's the stage when we were learning not only from the COs, but also from our orderlies, because they had seen a spate of such young officers come and go through tens or twenties of years. The way they would teach us how to keep our uniforms, handle our money, flying, maps, ranks. You have to get ready and run, and you know your maps are not ready, your uniform is not ready, ranks are not, I can't find them somewhere. And somebody would go and find them from somewhere without you realizing from where. So that was the charm, ma'am. Absolutely charmed by the first squadron experience. And I still feel, ma'am, we are here today just because of those minutes, hours, months, and years spent in the company of those people. That is what made us what we are today. Those were the times when people used to feel that Leh is a tough posting and we don't want to be there. I still remember till my last posting, till I finally reached Leh, every time when we were asked for the option, where would you want to be, choice of posting, it used to be number one Leh, number two Leh, number three Leh. From that point on. So that was the kind Wonderful. Of thing we had. And what pride, ma'am, what pride that time. And it's that company of the correct set of people who built that pride in us.
Absolutely. And which were the aircraft you were flying then? I mean, the choppers, which of them were you flying by then?
That time when we were commissioned, ma'am, we were only offered the single engines, the Chetak Cheetahs. And I'm so again thankful for that opportunity. That's true flying. That's real true flying. That young machine, which and you have the liberty to learn so much from scratch, when not only you are learning by from the books, you're also learning from handling that machine. You get independence a lot more earlier. When the aircraft is not so complicated, you are at a very, very early age, you get to command the aircraft, you get to command the mission, you get to sit on the captain's seat. It has its own charm. And I still feel, ma'am, it's the most beautiful aircraft in the whole world, even now.
That's spoken like a true Indian Air Force person, you know. The love and affection they have for those two choppers is just wonderful. I really can understand how you're feeling at the moment.
I remember, ma'am, and when we were going through the air show, I don't know how many years back was that, when we walked past those aircraft, and the moment I would look at the helicopter, everybody would say, your skin color changes the moment you look at them.
Absolutely. Yes, right. Yes, absolutely. And you reached Leh finally. And how was Leh like? It's one of those most beautiful places with very risky entries into it through the air. So just tell us a little more about it.
Finally, yes, ma'am, we did reach Leh. We were only commissioned for 10 years. And again, I got lucky. My finishing was back in Leh. Although we had some of our course mates already positioned there and we were looking forward to doing some good flying together. Those were the times wherein the women officers still had not received their clearances to fly as captain in enemy occupied terrains. So those ANE affected areas, we had a lot of restriction to fly in. Nonetheless, the Air Force was very, very supportive. So we could not be engaged for a longer time in critical missions. But yes, we had a very, very fair exposure of flying those critical missions, of flying in those difficult terrains, living in those difficult terrains, and proving our case yet another time that yes, given an opportunity, women officers will also prove to be equally effective and as professional as they are expected to be. And we have seen the effect of it in years to come, wherein now women are being handed larger and larger responsibilities, heavier aircraft to fly, more critical missions into the war zones, into relief operations, into so many other domains. I think they are proud of laying the foundation right at the right time.
They yes, couldn't absolutely. Have been. Yes, and were you a part of the Operation Vijay at Kargil? Were you there in the Indian Air Force that time?
Yes, ma'am. I was in the Air Force at that time. And some of our course mates also reached Udhampur and Srinagar and started to fly. And as the mission grew a little more critical, we all had to let the fighters take over. And the fog of war was really thick. Nobody actually knew at that time how it was going to be. We were 100% involved in all active missions. We continue to fly to the best of our ability. There are times we remember we were ticked off that we haven't logged enough. Whatever we had flown was not reported as much because we were all hungry to fly more. But yes, we counted on every single minute. We counted on supporting as much as we can. Considering also that we were rather young in service at that time, there was a lot of learning also involved. And at a young age, despite being an early commission, there was a lot more to gain at that time. Brilliant, ma'am. I think we couldn't have asked for more at that time, having flown in the Kargil and two active war zones. Again, yet proven to be lucky yet another time.
And you know, as and when we move towards the end of the show, there's a real great news which has just come in, which is that NDA has opened its doors for women, which is one of the historic decisions. And now you will have girls in NDA, and you know, the planning to join will be from a younger stage. So how does it feel?
Ma'am, I think it's been an effort of almost two decades, placed by so many other young officers, not only women, but also men. Men who have also learned to live with this kind of a fraternity, with the women in uniform. And now that we've arrived at a stage wherein I would feel now our parallel course mates are commanders. The men who have trained with women, the women who have trained with those men, and now they both are commanders in two different squadrons. That's the time wherein we can all lead the change from the front. And this is the opportune time wherein we are able to now welcome the women into the NDA. We are able to ensure that nobody is compromised. Everybody is offered equal opportunity to perform. And they are able to prove themselves as true professionals in this domain. So that's much, much more important.
Prerna, I think we'll now put an end to it and, you know, wait for the next time when we can talk more and more about it. I think the opportune time would be to have a repeat with you when it's nearer the Women's Day in March. And before that, you know, I'd just like to thank you from both mine and Chitali's side and ADU's for being here on the portal with us, discussing your memories of those wonderful days with the Indian Air Force. Thank you so much. And we're really looking forward to welcome you here again and again. All the best.
Thank you so much, Geeta ma'am, Chitali ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Pleasure to connect with both of you. Sangeeta ma'am, I think we have to head to the Paris Air Show one more time.
Next year.
Right next to those aircraft. One more time, ma'am.
Absolutely.
You ladies should include me as well.
Yes, absolutely.
100%. So good luck to the Middle East, Chaitali.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. It was a real pleasure to hear you.
And looking forward to seeing you right there.
Right, absolutely.
Me too. It's a real pleasure to hear you, ma'am. I'm very fortunate to hear the accounts from you, actually. And especially our audience will be very eager to listen to this video, see this video ahead. Thank you so much, ladies. Right. Have a great day.
Okay. Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, ma'am.
Bye, Prerna. Thank you very much. Bye. Bye.